Moderating our morning panel of speakers will be Dr. Stephen Davis. Professor Davis is an Earth System scientist at UCI who received his PhD in geological sciences from Stanford University and his JD from the University of Virginia. His current research focuses on carbon-embedded emissions in international trade, energy systems, climate change mitigation, and the interactions of agriculture and the global carbon cycle. Professor Davis co-founded two organizations related to climate change, the Climate Conservancy, a group working to assess and label consumer goods with their carbon footprints, and Near Zero, a nonprofit that aims to increase the frequency and value of dialogue between energy experts and those who make and influence energy-related decisions in government and business. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Stephen Davis.
Thanks very much, Simon, for that nice introduction. So I'm anxious to get to the meat of this. As Simon said, I work mostly on CO2 emissions and climate change, and in particular, how we might be able to transition our energy system to one that doesn't emit CO2 to the atmosphere. But today, of course, we're talking about what's sometimes been referred to as the other CO2 problem, ocean acidification. And to start us off, we've got a very prominent scholar in the field of ocean acidification, Dr. Richard Feeley from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Dr. Feeley has been working on this topic for a very long time. I promised him that I wouldn't say exactly how long for fear of embarrassing him, but I think I'm safe in saying that he's been measuring CO2 uptake in the ocean systems and the effects of that for several decades, even before they thought to call it ocean acidification. And so without any further ado, I'd like to have Dr. Feeley come and tell us some more about his contributions to the field. Thanks.
The group of speakers that are you're going to be presenting to you today are amongst the best in the world, and so I'm very happy to be here and participate in this process. It's really thrilling to do this, and I really assure you it's going to be a great day. So my job is just to present an overview of what ocean acidification is, why it affects our coastal environments, and why our coastal environments are particularly vulnerable to ocean acidification, and give you some sense of what the present impacts and what future impacts might be. So it's kind of a broad overview of the general topic. I'll try and highlight some of the things our speakers will be talking about later. So as we burn fossil fuel, coal, oil, and natural gas, all that goes up into the atmosphere. And since the beginning of the industrial period, we've released about 2 trillion tons of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere since about last 250 years or so. And about a quarter of that, about 25%, is taken up by the oceans. Up until about 15 years ago, we always thought that was a good thing, because when you think about it, if it wasn't for that ocean uptake of CO2, our atmosphere would be about 70 parts per million higher in CO2 than it is now. Right now, it's almost 400. And it would be much higher, 470. And our global temperatures would be about a half a degree warmer. So we thought that the uptake of carbon dioxide was a good thing, that the oceans were doing a service to mankind. But we now understand that carbon dioxide is an acid gas. It reacts with water and it forms carbonic acid, which lowers the pH. It decreases the carbonate ion concentrations. And these are measurable levels in the ocean that we as chemical oceanographers, myself and my colleagues, go out and measure every single year and see the changes. And this is what we call ocean acidification. Now, I want to show my first slide is from our sister laboratory, the Earth Systems Research Laboratory in NOAA in Boulder. And they collect samples of atmospheric gases throughout 63 stations throughout the world. And they monitor it on a weekly basis. And this is a plot. I'll show you how it works in a minute. But this is the South Pole and North Pole, and these are zonal average CO2 concentrations. We're going to start in 1996 and take it to the present. And I just want to show you what we can see about the atmospheric CO2. We know the atmosphere better than we know anything else, any other reservoir for CO2, because of these measurements. So this is the breathing of the Earth. It's the uptake of carbon dioxide in the northern hemisphere to plant life, taking it up in trees and plants, and the release due to respiration in the wintertime. And this is distributed throughout the world, so that you can see from, by your own eye, the short record, that the atmosphere is certainly increasing. It's increased and increases at the rate of about 2% per year, and that rate of increase is increasing because we increase the CO2 emissions every year by about 2.9%. So we know for certain from these measurements and from the isotopic composition of the carbon dioxide, this is due to man-made CO2 release. So this is just a portion of this Mauna Loa record, the atmospheric record. Mauna Loa record was started by Dr. Charles Keeling from Scripps in 1957, and he maintained that along with NOAA into the present, so they worked jointly on this. So here's the atmospheric record from 1989 onward, and here's the corresponding ocean PCO2 record taken at Station Aloha by the University of Hawaii, right underneath it. And what you see from this is the oceans take up carbon dioxide at approximately the same rate as the atmosphere. And from that, you then can calculate and measure the pH changes that are taking place. So from measurements alone, throughout the world oceans, at time series stations like this, we know that ocean acidification is taking place. These pH changes are on average about 0.02 pH units per decade. So we know conclusively that the chemistry of the ocean is changing because of the release of fossil fuel CO2 into the atmosphere. These are major changes. Now, the reactions are really simple. You all learned these reactions when you were in high school chemistry. I'm just repeating what you already know. So CO2 reacts with water to form carbonic acid. Carbonic acid is the same thing we have in soda water. So you know it very well. It gives us our fizz in the soda water. It releases a hydrogen. That's what gives us our acidic waters. And that hydrogen, 99.99% of that hydrogen reacts with carbonate to form bicarbonate. So in the process, we're consuming carbonate ions, and we're forming bicarbonate ions. And that small amount, 4 molecules of hydrogen ion concentration in every 100,000 molecules being released add to the acidic concentrations of seawater. And what happens then, over the course of the industrial era, the pH of seawater has dropped from 8.2 to 8.1. pH has dropped. That's a 30% increase in the hydrogen concentration in the global oceans and surface waters. And the carbonate ion concentrations has also dropped. It's dropped about 16%. If we take the IPCC projections out to the end of the century, we would see that the pH will drop another 0.3 or 0.4 pH units, which would be 100 to 150% increase in the hydrogen concentration out at the end of the century. In actual fact, we're exceeding those IPCC emissions right now, faster than expected. In addition to those changes, we also have local sources of CO2, as well as local sources of other acid gases, NOx and SOx, as well as inputs of nutrients, all adding to the additional acidification. And in some coastal regions, that's a 50% increase in acidification in those local regions from these other sources. So here are the areas where our states can take control and have an impact on the acidification in their local environments. Indeed, in the state of Washington now, there's legislation before the legislature to address these local sources of acidification. So we are moving in the direction of understanding both the global sources of acidification and the local sources of acidification. And you're going to hear a lot about that today. So what we know about ocean acidification for sure is that it is occurring rapidly. 25% of the CO2 that's generated ends up in the ocean every single year. This has increased the acidity of the ocean by 30% since the start of the industrial age. Ocean acidity is projected to increase by 100 to 150% by the end of the century. And the current acidification is nearly 10 times faster than anything we've seen over the last 50 million years. It's probably faster than anything we've seen over the last 300 million years. It's just that the record is not as clear about that yet. So one of the deniers will say is the oceans will never become acidic, so calling ocean acidification is alarmist. We as scientists call ocean acidification the process of lowering the pH, not the end state. So it's the direction that we're headed that's critical. And if I grew up in Minnesota and when it was 40 below, it was really cold. And when it got to be 10 below, we thought this was a warming cycle. This is the same thing. We're talking about pHs of seawater about 8.2. We're moving in the direction towards an acid condition. That's why we have the term ocean acidification. In your medical field, that same term is called acidosis, even though the pH of your blood is basic. In fact, your pH is about 7.45 to 7.35. If you drop your pH 0.2 units and still is basic, you will be in a coma. That's how sensitive your body is to changes in acidification. So we look at what has been going on over the last century and into the next century. We are seeing changes now 100 times faster than we've seen for the last 400,000 years for the changes in CO2. This is the changes the organisms have to adapt to or to evolve from. And we're changing that chemistry basically every 30 to 40 years. They see a whole new chemistry because the changes take place. Another important component of understanding ocean acidification is calcium carbonate and calcium carbonate minerals. So calcium ions are everywhere, ubiquitous in seawater, they're almost the same concentration everywhere. They combine with a carbonate ion to form calcium carbonate. This is the shells and skeletons of coral reefs, of lobsters, of clams and oysters, and they form a calcium carbonate. So they're dependent on this changing carbonate ion concentration, which I told you already is decreasing by about 16%. And by the end of the century, it'll have decreased by 50%. So we have, as geochemists, a term called saturation state. That is an indication of where the organism is capable of producing their shell or skeleton. So when the saturation state is greater than 1, that means it is capable of producing that shell or skeleton. When it is less than 1, the shell or skeleton will begin to dissolve. We know this very well with the chemistry of seawater. We know it by most organisms have an impact very close to 1, sometimes a little higher than 1, sometimes a lower than 1. But for some species, this impact of dissolution occurs while the organism is still alive. Other organisms have developed protective capabilities of that. So you have to look at each organism, see how they function. It's the calcium concentration times this carbonate divided by the apparent solubility product. That apparent solubility product is high when the temperatures are low or when the pressures are high. So we see very high numbers as saturation states, usually about 2 to 4 for aragonite, 4 to 6 for calcite in surface waters. That's why they can produce their shells and skeletons. In deep water, they're all less than 1, so they begin to dissolve. So there's some place where dissolution occurs. My job is to figure out where dissolution occurs. That's what I do for a living. And that becomes very important. The most important common biogenic minerals are aragonite, which is more soluble, and calcite. Aragonite are things like pteropods and corals. Calcite are things like coccolithophrids and forams. So what we do is we go on cruises that go from Alaska to Antarctica, from Japan to America, throughout the world. We collect samples in Niskin bottles on Rosette package. These Rosette packages go to the bottom of the ocean. We collect samples, 32 samples, on the way to the surface. We analyze all the samples in between stations, working around the clock, and we get about 4,000 or 5,000 samples per cruise. And we get a very good picture of how the chemistry of the ocean is changing. We also have moorings in which you can deploy moorings and measure the chemistry of seawater on these moorings surface to bottom. We do that quite well. And what we have found is that all the anthropogenic CO2, all the man-made CO2, here's the Atlantic, here's the North Atlantic, South Atlantic, here's Pacific, here's the Indian Ocean. It's all still in the upper part of the water column, upper 1,500 meters, where most of our organisms live. The reason why it's still up there is because the circulation in the ocean is very slow. It goes from the North Atlantic down to the bottom of the ocean, along the bottom of the ocean, through the Indian Ocean to the Pacific and back up in the North Pacific. And that takes about 1,000 years to 1,500 years to do so. So most of the anthropogenic CO2, except for in the North Atlantic, is still up in the upper 1,500 meters or so. where it's having its impact. So, as I said, my job has been to determine where this undersaturation occurs, and this is the depth of the undersaturation for aragonite and calcite. And the interesting thing is that it's actually very deep in the North Atlantic. It's about 2,500 meters for aragonite and 3,500 meters for calcite, except for here off of Africa. But in the Pacific, it's really shallow. If we could see the Arctic Ocean, it's about 100 meters or so. Along Alaska, it's about 100 meters. Along our coast, it's right around the shelf break, right at about 200 meters. So anything that will push that water onto the shelf is going to cause corrosive waters to come onto the shelf. And you can see this goes all the way down to South America. So here's a very vulnerable area for acidification in an area we're particularly interested in. And same thing is true here in the Indian Ocean. So the oceans are different from different ocean basins, and you have to take that into account. Now, the IPCC projections have done a nice thing for us. What they have done is say, what would happen if we stopped CO2 emissions in 2000? What would happen if we really restricted emissions? And what would happen if we let everything go and let emissions go the way they are? And here's the output from that. So here's the three scenarios, stopping it at 2000 level, stopping it at about a 500 parts per million level, and letting it go and let CO2 emissions go up so it maximizes emissions to about 800 parts per million at the year 2100. And what you see, of course, here's the projections for temperature that we all know very well. We're all concerned whether or not we can keep it below 2 degrees C, but perhaps with the CO2 emissions in the A2 scenario, we're going to go well above that 2 degree limit. And here's the atmospheric CO2 that would have result from that, 450 if we restrict CO2 emissions right around 450. And you can see if we don't, we can see CO2 emissions as high as 850. Some scenarios suggest over 1,000 parts per million. Big difference in atmospheric CO2. And here's the saturation state that would be caused by that. You can see a precipitous drop in saturation state down to levels of about 1.8, the average for all of seawater. So you can see very, very many dramatic drops in saturation state as a result, depending on which scenario we choose to use. Even at 2.9, we will see impacts. This next slide is a very wonderful slide put together by Sarah Cooley and Scott Doney. And it's a model projection of what the saturation state of surface water will look at beginning in 1880, which it is right now, right here. This shows 1880 saturation state. So the blue colors are good conditions for our high saturation state. That means the corals can do quite fine. Our clams and oysters can do entirely fine. You can see in the Arctic regions, they're already struggling because the saturation state is less than 1.5. So you don't see corals in the Arctic Ocean. And we can see now, project this out using the same IPCC scenario and see what happened to the world oceans in their saturation state. So you can see, start going in the 1900s, we're beginning to see man-made changes. Comes very, very dramatic by the time we see 2000, so we've seen significant changes. But projecting out into the Indian, this is huge changes. The entire Arctic Ocean would become undersaturated. The North Pacific would become undersaturated. The North Atlantic would become undersaturated. And the entire Southern Ocean would become undersaturated. Surface to bottom, undersaturated. The saturation state in our tropical regions would be so low that they would have impacts to some of the coral species. And we'll talk about that in a little more detail, but you can see that this represents a very dramatic global impact. Along our coast, we have another unique vulnerability that's part of the natural environment that happens every year. In the wintertime, the winds are from the south and we have downwelling events. And so those saturation depths are pushed downward. But in the summertime, the winds are shifted, and the Pacific high causes the winds to come from the north. And when the winds come from the north, then that pushes the surface waters by Coriolis effect offshore and pulls the bottom water right along the bottom of the ocean from that shelf region at the shelf break all the way to the beach first, and then outward from the beach. So this is bringing the corrosive waters that are normally sitting here at the shelf break along the bottom to the surface and then outward from the surface. So this is an impact. So all the organisms that are affected along the bottom, and our hatcheries that get affected by this upwelled water are affected. Now, and this is going to be a model. It's a one-year model that's put together by Nikki Gruber, gave it to me. The blue colors are the acidified water. It starts in January 3rd. I'm going to take you through. You watch the blue colors. You can see there is some upwelling in the wintertime, not much. But watch the changes that take place when these winds changes. Keep your eye on day 90. So a day is in the top left-hand corner. That's when the major change takes place. I want to show you how it affects our coastline. This goes from Washington to Southern California. And here's San Francisco Bay in the middle. Okay, so we're getting to day 90. Now you see the blues. All of a sudden, the big shift. The blues are through the entire region through the summertime. They're always at the beach, and they go out in the open ocean. This is that upwelled water. Everywhere we see it, and then you see it dissipate by the end of the fall. So this is that upwelling process. So it's drawing nutrient-rich waters in, causes a great productivity, but it's bringing those corrosive waters right to the beach. So what are the effects on marine organisms? Why do we care about this? Organisms have to withstand lots of pressures, not just acidification. So first of all, I want to say this is what we see, is that when you have a change to the CO2 system, the dissolved concentration of CO2 goes up, the bicarbonate goes up, the carbonate goes down, the pH goes down. This has the impact of increasing photosynthesis in some organisms. So there can be more biological activity in some species of phytoplankton. It decreases calcification rate in most calcifiers, and it changes the physiology. There are other stresses we have to take into account, the temperature effect of global warming, the decreasing oxygen that we expect to see over the next century, and other factors such as overfishing, pollution, noise pollution. These can all combine with acidification. So it's the combined products that the organisms see. And we need to figure out how these split out, and do they exacerbate each other, like temperature and CO2 together, do they exacerbate each other in terms of the impact or not? These are the issues we need to look at. So we have the challenge of multiple stressors. Now, we do conduct these studies in laboratories. Gretchen has a wonderful laboratory where she conducts studies. Usually, we have very sophisticated systems where we control the impact of CO2 for a given organism, or we can have a larger mesoscale kind of, so this is Biosphere 2, we create a whole ocean and control the atmosphere, or we actually go out in the field and have mesocosm experiments out in the field. We do all these things. We actually do them quite well, and we have very good results that are coming out of that. And what we find is that in most cases, each species of organism behaves a little bit differently. We have to understand that. Some are very, very sensitive. Corals are particularly sensitive, and others seem to be more resilient. Even within corals, there's a difference in sensitivity. So we have a lot to figure out like that. But the thing we have to think about is that these species are important to mankind. They're important for food. Bill Dewey will talk about the impacts in a moment on the oyster industry. There are coral systems and the clam systems, they provide habitat for other organisms. So not only are they people food, but they are fish food. The pteropods, for example, which I'll talk about in a minute, are the primary food source for juvenile pink salmon. So we have to think about the food chain, how it affects the food chain. And those predator-prey relationships. And the ecosystem itself. How does the ecosystem respond? These are challenging issues for our marine scientists now. And a good example of this is what we call the West Coast oyster seed crisis. Bill's going to talk about this a lot. I just want to introduce that. In 2006 and 2007, there was a major decrease in the number of oyster larvae that were produced in the hatcheries. And there was essentially a failure occurring, and we didn't know why. And Bill will explain the details of that. But this is an important thing because just the oyster industry is about a $110 million industry, about 3,200 jobs along our coast of Washington, Oregon, and California. And it turns out this is all due to the low pH of these waters getting into the hatcheries and affecting the oyster larvae. And we worked on that right in the hatchery itself, and this is the very first paper that came out, Bartnell, one of the hatchery scientists, showing the relative production of the oysters is the direct function of the aragonite saturation state. And the way this is presented, at a saturation state of 1.6, They can no longer increase their numbers. So that's the first tipping point you ever see for ocean acidification, where we can no longer produce numbers. By the time you get to saturation state of 1.0, they're all dead. So here's a very clear and precise example of the impact of ocean acidification. And it turns out there's a good reason for that. When the oysters are just hatched, they have an egg yolk. They need a certain amount of energy to begin producing their shells. The more pressure, the more difficult you have to produce that shell or skeleton, the more they use up that egg yolk energy. And if they use it all up, they die. This is why it happens just like that. And we can see impacts on the shells in terms of their how they're formed or malformed. Very clear. What about marine ecosystems? We have good examples in the field now of changes in marine ecosystems. We do this by looking ahead in time, going to places where there's natural seeps of CO2. This is one in Milne Bain that Fabricius and I reported on. And it starts out, here's a natural seep of CO2 here. pHs are about 7.8. That's about this pH that you're going to see at the end of the century. And you can see here CO2 bubbles coming from the seafloor. This is because it's a volcanic region. It's releasing 98% CO2 in these bubbles. Here is away from that CO2 release, very rich, 45 different species of corals. By the time we get to this seep area, about 43 of those 45 species have disappeared. So you can think about what this means. We have a glimpse into the future when we look at these natural seeps like this and what that means for our ecosystems. Another example I'm very close to is the pteropod. Gretchen has been working on pteropods in Antarctica. Here's an example of the impact on live pteropods on their shell when placed in 1,100 parts per million CO2 water at 3 degrees C for 29 days. I want to show you the little movie that I have of this. Pteropods are beautiful organisms. They live at about 100 meters depth. They swim to the surface to feed at night. Then they sink back down to 100 meters at day. They try and avoid being eaten by salmon. This dissolution occurs while the animal is still alive. So we are seeing now the impacts of dissolution, very serious impacts. Dr. Nina Benarsek, who's a postdoc in my lab, has shown that in the Southern Ocean, that just the impact of upwelling and anthropogenic CO2 causes the kind of dissolution we're seeing in the laboratory. So these are real life impacts that we're seeing right now. A very important discovery that it's happening right now in major ecosystems. So what we do know is that the whole ocean acidification issue permeates through the food web. Here's an example of a very simple North Pacific food web. Here's our coccolithophorids. 11% of the plants produce this calcium carbonate shell that can be affected by acidification. They're generally eaten by copepods or these pteropods. The salmon particularly like to eat the copepods and pteropods. That's where they get food. So it permeates through the food chain. And some of the work that our National Marine Fisheries Service has shown is indeed the pink salmon, about 50% of the diet in their first year class are these pteropods. And a 10% decrease in pteropod production rate would lead to a 20% drop in the weight of pink salmon adults. This is particularly important to our industry in the Pacific Northwest because both our culture and our seafood industry is dependent on these type of ecosystem changes. Now, just looking at the seafood industry as a whole in the United States, seafood industry itself at the pier where the fishing boats come in is about a $4 billion industry in the United States. About half of that, $2 billion, are the shellfish that are directly affected by acidification. The other half are finfish, and about half of those finfish eat shellfish for their livelihoods. So that's how the ecosystem works. It's for the GDP of the United States, that's about $37 billion when you take in the restaurants and the grocery stores and that impact. So it's a big deal in terms of our economy, and it's a big deal worldwide. We get protein from the oceans about enough to support anywhere about 500 million to a billion people. And many of those people that live in island nations, most of their protein sources come from the sea. So we need to think about what the impacts of ocean acidification are on our ecosystems and how that might affect our seafood security. I've just talked about calcification, right? There are many, many, many impacts that scientists have identified of ocean acidification. pH is one of the most important factors affecting the chemical composition, the species composition, many elements and compounds in seawater. Sort of a master variable because it controls the speciation. So many of our toxic elements and many of our chemical species are affected by pH. So how we change the pH may affect the toxicity of many, many elements. There's changes in sound absorption. The reduced homing ability, where an organism can get back to home, depends on that. One of the most interesting, I thought, new discoveries is that even changes in behavior responses are affected by pH. Some recent work has shown that the neuroreceptors of the clownfish, Nemo, are directly dependent on reactions that occur with CO2, such that their response to avoiding predators or moving towards predators are dependent on the level of CO2 in their bloodstream. And it turns out that at certain levels of CO2, they go right towards the predators instead of moving away from them. You can see how these physiological responses would have significant impacts. We're just beginning to understand some of those. This would have very striking impacts on the whole ecosystem when you think how this would work through the food chain. What we know so far is very little. This is a very new science. We have only done very simple experiments with single species, very short term for the most part. We have not looked at a number of important things. Gretchen will talk about this, responsive genetically diverse population. There's some hope because of genetically diverse populations give different responses. There's hope out there, and she'll talk about that. Synergistic effects with other stressors, temperature, trace metals. There's some recent research that shows that increasing CO2 affects the toxicity of harmful algal blooms, not only the abundance of those plumes, but the concentration of those toxic poisons. Community and ecosystem responses, species replacement. CO2, the impacts of ocean acidification actually can reverberate back into the atmosphere and have an impact on the atmosphere and therefore global warming. Within the U.S., we have 8 federal agencies working on the Federal Ocean Acidification Research and Monitoring Act. We have a meeting every month. We work together designing a strategic plan, which is just about to be released to Congress, for observing ocean acidification, for determining ecosystem impacts, modeling changes to the global environment, looking at adaptation strategies, education outreach. These are major institutions like the National Science Foundation, working with NOAA, the USGS, NASA, the Navy. We're all working together to have one cohesive plan. We're working not only at the national level, but we're now working at the international level through the International Coordination Center for Ocean Acidification in Monaco and through the IOCCP, the International Ocean Carbon Coordination Project. 2 major projects that are addressing these issues, hopefully to develop an international observing system for ocean acidification. That's one of my primary goals. At the local level, the state of Washington has developed a blue ribbon panel. They just recently, in November, released their report. Jay Manning will be here to talk about it in particular. I just wanted to point, for the state of Washington alone, shellfish industry is $270 million annually, 3,200 jobs. This is why the state of Washington invested in a major ocean acidification report, because it has so much dependency on their jobs and their GDP. So this was signed by Governor Krogar in November 27th. She accepted the recommendations. There were 42 recommendations for science and policy and outreach. And she's had implemented many of those recommendations, particularly the request that the EPA assess their water quality assessment for ocean acidification. And just last week, the EPA responded with a letter back to the governor saying they would work on that problem, develop new water quality criteria. This is a perfect example of how things should work. Scientists and administrators and policymakers at the local level can pressure the federal government to do something at the national level. This is the way we should be working, and the way, this is how we really move public policy forward. I hope we discuss that a lot today. So in conclusion then, ocean acidification is acidifying rapidly. Local species are sensitive to changes. Biological responses are variable, so we have to look at them individually. Impacts of ocean acidification do impact the food webs. Other stresses can exacerbate the response to ocean acidification, and the economic consequences are significant. I'll stop there, and thank you very much.